our second one is in the Faith We Sing, 2065. More precious than silver. So Sharon and I want to thank you for the opportunity to go on vacation a couple weeks ago. We enjoyed our vacation traveling to Virginia and Pennsylvania to visit with friends and family, some of whom I haven't seen in several years. Special thanks to Jim LeGros for filling the pulpit and bringing what I thought was a very inspiring message last Sunday. And to everyone else who worked double duty to make the worship experience at the Rhode Island United Methodist Church the wonderful thing that it is while I wasn't here. So welcome to worship on this 16th Sunday after Pentecost at the Rhode Island United Methodist Church. Are there any announcements we need to share this morning? Quick board meeting after church. Downstairs?
Not sure.
Okay, downstairs. There is coffee downstairs.
There's pie
here. Ah.
There's a variety of tomatoes and some yellow squash in the foyer here if anybody is interested.
So there are some vegetables in the foyer. Please empty the basket on your way out. Then Chris and Tyler won't have to carry it back to the car. Three people have expressed interest in becoming members of the Rhode Island United Methodist Church. I'm planning on setting up a series of meetings, probably two, with some of them, and would like to invite others who are not members to join us if you would like to consider becoming part of our official congregation. Any other announcements? The verse for this morning is Mark chapter 8, verse 27. Jesus went on with his disciples to the villages of Caesarea Philippi. And on the way, he asked his disciples, "Who do people say that I am?"
Thank you.
Would you join me for the call of worship? Wisdom shouts out her warning in the street. We have come to forsake our foolish ways. Wisdom longs to pour out her spirit on all flesh. We will not shrink from her blessings. Wisdom imparts holy knowledge to save us. Let us worship in spirit and in truth. Our next hymn is number 145 in the hymnal, Morning Has Broken.
Thank you. Today's Old Testament reading comes from the book of Proverbs, chapter 1, verses 20 through 33. Wisdom cries out in the street, in the squares she raises her voice. At the busiest corner she cries out, at the entrance of the city gates she speaks. How long, O simple ones, will you love being simple? How long will scoffers delight in their scoffing and fools hate knowledge? Give heed to my reproof. I will pour out my thoughts to you. I will make my words known to you. Because I have called and you refused, have stretched out my hand and no one heeded, and because you have ignored all my counsel and would have none of my reproof, I also will laugh at your calamity. I will mock when panic strikes you, when panic strikes you like a storm and your calamity comes like a whirlwind, when distress and anguish come upon you. Then they will call upon me, but I will not answer. They will seek me diligently, but will not find me. Because they hated knowledge and did not choose the fear of the Lord, would have none of my counsel and despised all my reproof. Therefore, they shall eat the fruit of their way and be sated with their own devices. For waywardness kills the simple, and the complacency of fools destroys them. But those who listen to me will be secure and will live at ease without dread of disaster. Today's epistle comes from the book of James, chapter 3, verses 1 through 12. Not many of you should become teachers, my brothers and sisters, for you know that we who teach will be judged with greater strictness. For all of us make many mistakes. Anyone who makes no mistakes in speaking is perfect, able to keep the whole body in check with a bridle. If we put bits into the mouths of horses to make them obey us, we guide their whole bodies. Or look at ships. Though they are so large that it takes strong winds to drive them, yet they are guided by a very small rudder, wherever the will of the pilot directs. So also the tongue is a small member, yet it boasts of great exploits. How great a forest is set ablaze by a small fire, and the tongue is a fire. The tongue is placed among our members as a world of iniquity. It stains the whole body, sets on fire the cycle of nature, and is itself set on fire by hell. For every species of beast and bird, of reptile and sea creature can be tamed, and has been tamed by the human species. But no one can tame the tongue, a restless evil full of deadly poison. With it we bless the Lord and Father, and with it we curse those who are made in the likeness of God. From the same mouth come blessing and cursing. My brothers and sisters, this ought not to be so. Does a spring pour forth from the same opening both fresh and brackish water? Can a fig tree, my brothers and sisters, yield olives, or a grapevine figs? No more can salt water yield fresh. Today's gospel lesson comes from the book of Mark, chapter 8, verses 27 through 38. Jesus went on with his disciples to the villages of Caesarea Philippi, and on the way he asked his disciples, "Who do people say that I am?" And they answered him, "John the Baptist," and others, "Elijah," and still others, "one of the prophets." He asked them, "But who do you say that I am?" Peter answered him, "You are the Messiah." And he sternly ordered them not to tell anyone about him. Then he began to teach them that the Son of Man must undergo great suffering and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, and the scribes, and be killed, and after 3 days rise again. He said all this quite openly, and Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. But turning and looking at his disciples, he rebuked Peter and said, "Get behind me, Satan, for you are setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things." He called the crowd with his disciples and said to them, "If any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake and for the sake of the gospel will save it. For what will it profit them to gain the whole world and forfeit their life? Indeed, what can they give in return for their life? Those who are ashamed of me and of my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of them the Son of Man will also be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father with the holy angels. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God. And other patriotic creeds and slogans. These slogans warned American citizens to avoid spreading information related to shipping on the Atlantic Ocean. The government wanted to protect American interests on the high seas as the Germans were mounting their U-boat campaign, sinking cargo and passenger ships bound for Europe to assist in the war effort there. Another saying, sticks and stones may break my bones, but words will never hurt me, has turned out to be incorrect in my life and should be considered incorrect in our society, where words are often used to both hurt and sometimes to heal relationships between people. Our words may have an unintended negative effect on some who hear them, if we do not consider carefully what we're saying. They can make or break relationships, reveal our true feelings, and cause us anxiety if we don't understand the full effect of them on all who might hear them. Jesus is using words in our gospel reading this morning, where Mark describes a conversation between him and his disciples as they walk through the villages of Caesarea Philippi. Now Jesus asked them, "Who do people say that I am?" And they replied, "John the Baptist and others, Elijah and still others, maybe one of the prophets." So this is not the important question for Jesus. And he responds with a second question, which is the point he's really trying to get at. "But who do you say that I am?" And Peter uses his words for the entire group, declaring, "You are the Messiah." Peter's response seems conclusive and affirms who he believes Jesus is and what Jesus' earthly mission is about. But Jesus sternly orders them not to tell anyone. Perhaps Jesus doesn't want them to spread the word that he is the Messiah because the people might interpret his message incorrectly. He goes on to explain to the disciples that in order to complete his earthly message, he must undergo great suffering and death. This causes an outburst from Peter again, this time rebuking Jesus privately. In responding to Peter, Jesus turns to the disciples and calls him Satan. Strong words. Words that surely must have stung Peter. It's what he said before, as "you are the Messiah," seemed right to him. Now he wondered why Jesus was dampening the moment with all this talk of suffering and death. Jesus wants his words to be clear to Peter and his disciples and the crowds. He knows and understands that suffering and death are in his future and the future of those who will commit to following him. He's preparing them for the road ahead. And he makes it clear when rebuking Peter that the suffering and death that he faces will be their fate as his followers. He wants to give them no false illusions. Jesus is a teacher. And in James's letter, we get another vision of how our words affect others. James is writing about the responsibility of those who would be teachers in the first century church. Now, teachers held an important ministry in the early church because of their influence over others, especially in their understanding of faith. They had a serious responsibility to teach the truth. In verse 6, James writes that the tongue brings to the world of evil into our lives. The tongue's destructive power is such that it affects the whole life, from the cradle to the grave. He reminds his readers that humans were created in God's image and likeness. And when we use our words to curse another person, we are actually cursing God. James elevates the words and power of words to the ultimate level, implying that it is a life and death issue, a salvation issue. So yesterday, like many of us, I was watching some of the speeches around the 9/11 memorial. As I listened to George W. Bush's speech yesterday at Shanksville, Pennsylvania, I was struck by the power of his words. In part of the speech, he said, "On America's day of trial and grief, I saw millions of people instinctively grab for their neighbor's hand and rally to the cause of one another. That is the America I know." At a time when religious bigotry might have flowed freely, I saw Americans reject prejudice and embrace people of Muslim faith. That is the nation I know. At a time when nativism could have stirred hatred and violence against people perceived as outsiders, I saw Americans reaffirm their welcome to immigrants and refugees. That is the nation I know. At a time when some viewed the rising generation as individualistic and decadent, I saw young people embrace an ethic of service and rise to selfless action. That is the nation I know. With these words, the 43rd President of the United States reminded us of all the things that made our country great in a critical time in our history. The actions and attributes of the American people helped pull the country out of the agony and loss that the 9/11 terrorists wanted to drive us to. Those are the actions and attributes which followers of Jesus Christ can ascribe to today, 20 years and 1 year, 1 day after that horrific attack. Now in Proverbs, wisdom sets a good example for preachers like John Wesley, with her habit of preaching in the open air. Wisdom cries out in the street. In the square, she raises her voice. At the busiest corner, she cries out. At the entrance to the city gates, she speaks. However, we are not all preachers or public speakers, but we all have words. And when we speak, we need to choose our words carefully if we expect to shine the light of God's love on those who hear them. James makes a convincing argument that the words we use reflect our relationships with and belief in Jesus as the Lord of our lives. He He is exposing that lie, which says I can compartmentalize my life and give Jesus parts of me, but not all of me. James writes that the tongue is a small thing, and yet this small thing just might provide direction for all of us. Who are we really following? And where are we headed? Do our words reflect the cross that Jesus bore for all who follow him? Do our words reflect our roots in him? The fruit we produce with our words reveals the thoughts that we carry in our hearts. Amen. Of course, I would ask everyone to keep the families of those who lost loved ones, both in the 9/11 attacks and in the aftermath of those attacks, as the rescue effort continued, and for the soldiers who went to war to protect our country.
It's Dave's birthday today.
For 20 years, his birthday's had to follow 9/11, and this year it happened again.
So Dave's birthday is today. Gracious and merciful God, May the words of our mouths and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable in your heart, O God, our rock and our redeemer. All these things we ask in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And our last hymn is number 415 in the hymnal. Take up thy cross. Just as we leave this place, may the actions of our lives be compassionate and just. May the stirrings of our hearts be guided by God's thoughts and wisdom. Blessing.